Hey guys, and welcome back to another Lost Bits video right here on Tetra Bay Gaming, the series where we explore the unused, scrapped, and unseen content in gaming. I'm really excited to finally be taking a look into one of my all-time favorite Mario games, Super Mario Bros. 3. This game has sold over 17 million copies, and it remains to be one of the highest-grossing video games of all time. Thanks, the Wizard. Anyways, guys, go grab your power glove.
It's so bad.
It's time to find some Lost Bits. So, Super Mario Bros. 3 has quite a few unused graphics, so let's start there. Kicking things off, we have some shrubs? Yay. It looks like this sprite would have been tiled together to make these bushes seem a lot more dense. In the final game, this is all we got. I don't know, I really like the depth the unused style added, so it's a shame this was changed. Next are some grassland border tiles for the ends of the grass segments to properly close them off, instead of them just awkwardly ending. Then we have an early version of the clouds seen in World 5. If you compare the early version with the final one, you'll notice that they're almost the same, but they're shaped a tiny bit differently and the shading is improved with the one that's used. Next we got an unused sprite of Frog Mario facing the screen, which looks similar to the one that is used in the overworld. An open version of the small chest seen throughout the game, which normally just disappears. A P symbol, and an unused sprite of Toad. Now, these last two are found amongst the graphics for the King's Chambers and letters from Princess Toadstool, so it is believed that they are somehow related and were likely intended to be used there. The Toad, probably an early version of the Toad seen in the King's Chambers, and the P symbol is a bigger mystery. At first, I assumed it could have been something related to using the P-switches, but based on where it's found, my best guess is that it could have been either a stamp used for the letters from the princess, or a placeholder graphic for an attached P-Wing power-up. Next up is this square, and if it doesn't look familiar, this is actually the square surrounding the item cards at the end of each level. So yeah, this technically is used, but I'm still including it since most of it, namely the black border and rounded edges, are unseen due to the graphic being placed over top of the black background. Interestingly, these squares can actually be seen without a black background by hacking the game and loading into the throne room as a playable level. If you go past where you normally see, then yeah, you'll find a few of these square graphics. Just a few. Moving along, there's also an unused sprite of a skull that is found amongst the graphics for map objects like the tanks and Hammer Bros. So I think this may have been a graphic that would pop up after defeating one of those enemies on the map, but it's more likely it's just an unused alternate graphic for the skulls seen in World 8. And while we're talking about the maps, there's also a different version of the mid-castle seen throughout the game. Not sure if it was a different type or just an early version of the one that is used, since they look pretty similar. Then there's also an unused question mark tile, which could really be anything. An early version of the Toadhouse minigames, a random item drop, who knows. And finally for the map screen, there are two normally unused animations for Mario walking left, which could also be mirrored to go right, as well as Mario moving up. It is believed that Super Mario Bros. 3 would have had Mario move in all four directions like in Super Mario World, but unfortunately, I assume, due to hardware limitation, in the final release, Mario is only seen facing towards the map screen. Now, Mario facing upwards technically is used as it can be seen for a frame or two as Mario is spinning back to the start of a world once choosing continue after getting a game over, but it's unlikely this is its intended purpose as the left and right facing sprites are still unused. You also might be thinking, hey now, that's just the animation that Mario uses when climbing a beanstalk. But no, surprisingly, they are a little bit different. Anyways, moving along, now meant for the desert-themed levels, unused we have these tiles, this floating platform thing, this tile that looks to be part of a pillar or something, this sandstone block, this tile that appears to be some chains, this tile set which appears to contain various things such as a ladder, some broken wall, some shiny goop or something, and what looks like some purple pipe pieces. Now apart from this tile set, there's also this purple pipe connector, which is breakable, resulting in this also otherwise unused graphic. Apparently all of these breakable purple blocks were just replaced with the standard brick blocks in these desert levels. Then we also got something that resembles plant life meant for the ice-themed stages. This graphic, which would have been used to stack clouds as seen here, and these are actually seen in an unused stage, which we'll talk about later. Then there's this weird propeller thing, probably meant for some underwater stages. This sprite, believed to once be intended for the top of the door during the Bowser fight, as well as these unused graphics from World 8, which include a tire, propeller, some drills, and large tank treads. Then finally, we also have this unused block that's only seen in an also unused two-player stage, as well as this Goomba who's looking pretty sad. Now this Goomba was apparently meant to appear in the ending of the game. Now finally, moving on from the unused sprites, next up we have some unused color palettes that go unused in certain stages. These are basically just different colors that stages could have appeared in, but never do. And these range from slightly cool to not that cool at all, so let's quickly just bang through them. From best to worst, we have the giant stages from World 4 that have an unused grayscale palette, which I think looks really cool. A seafoam green palette for the fortress stages, a version of the plains levels with a pinkish background, and lastly, an unused color palette that basically just slightly changes the blue as seen here. Yeah, I know, really cool. Now onto some unused mode features. First up is one from the two-player Mario Bros. Mode. There appears to have been a scrapped feature that would allow a player to respawn after dying. Normally, once getting hit by an enemy, the game ends. But with this feature, once hit, the player will be respawned and will flicker and then remain invincible until an input is made. This feature can actually still be loaded into the game with the following Game Genie code. You better like this mode though, because if you use this code, you'll be stuck here until you reset your console. The other unused mode features are actually several scrapped bonus games that have their remnants actually left over in the game. Now in the final game, we only see this schlub as the minigame host, but it appears that a Koopa Troopa and Hammer Bro were also planned to be hosts as well. A Koopa would have also appeared alongside this pink question block, which reminds me of that other unused question block I mentioned earlier. Maybe that was meant to be the map sprite for entering this bonus game. In addition to the unused game hosts, there are also 5 unused background styles. One with no table, one with a box of corrupted graphics, one with just a brick background, one with a messed up orange box, and one with a broken tall object. Now, the unused hosts and backgrounds are cool and all, but what about actual unused bonus games? Well, there's actually unused Japanese text left over in the game, which gives us a glimpse into what these bonus games were meant to be. The first game, referred to as the Dice Game, would have had the player roll a dice with different outcomes. Rolling a 1 would grant the player a 1-up, rolling a 2 would result in some key, and any other number would grant the player coins amounting to 10 times the number they rolled. I'm sure we've all seen the slot machine and card matching bonus games that are in the game, but apparently there was also supposed to be a set of bonus games that would precede them. In one, you would only proceed to the slot machine style bonus game if you managed to roll an odd number within 3 dice rolls, and the other one would have been very similar in which you could only progress to the memory matching game if you roll an even number. Next up are 2 undefined bonus games which have been all but scrapped from the game, and all that's left are the following instructions. I'm sure CCCC and DDDDD would have been my favorite bonus games. And lastly is the unused bonus game just known as Back, since that's all that's left in the Japanese text stream. This is apparently the bonus game that was to specifically feature the Koopa with the pink box. It's pretty confusing, but apparently based on the item on the box and which direction you entered the bonus game from on the map, the Koopa would warp you to 2 predetermined locations. So I interpret this as a risk to either get sent forward in the map to skip some levels, or potentially setting you back, I assume to replay the levels that you've so far completed. A hacker known as Southbird actually made the excellent mock-up you've been seeing me play of what this minigame and all the other ones could have been intended to be like. And as you can see, completing this minigame sends me packing to a predetermined tile on the map, unfortunately softlocking me there. All in all, these unfinished and scrapped minigames seem pretty awesome and would have added some nice spice or variety than just the roulette and card game offered. If you've been around the channel for a while, you know I absolutely love debug features, and thankfully, Super Mario Bros. 3 delivers. By using the following Game Genie code, both the game's debug mode and stage select can be accessed on the title screen. With the debug mode enabled, by pressing start on the title screen, you can enable the level select, which is hard to see, but it's this tiny little chunk of Mario's head, which is the cursor. Aside from that, there's no real text or interface here, so you kind of just have to count and keep track of which world you're on. Also, by pressing the A button, you can increase the amount of lives you start the game with by 5. This is also really hard to see, but this little tile here will change every time you press A. Being able to quickly select which world you want to start in is pretty nifty. Or if you're feeling like just skipping through the whole game, by pressing A, B, and down on a second controller, you'll get right to rescuing Peach. And if that's too much gameplay for you and you want to just attempt the fastest speedrun of this game ever, pressing A, B, and right will warp you directly to the final curtain. Anyways, while playing an actual stage, the debug mode will also allow you to cycle through all of Mario's power-ups at will by pressing select. And by pressing A or B and select, it will also instantly give Mario the Karibo shoe. But its graphic will look pretty messed up if it's not in a stage it's supposed to be. Additionally, although the timer does still count down, running out of time will no longer kill Mario. Great news for all of you that have only dreamed of spending over 15 minutes exploring the first level. There were apparently supposed to be even more features in this debug mode, like a free movement mode that I assume would just let you move around and through objects freely, as well as the option to toggle invincibility. Otherwise, that's basically it for the debug mode. It's certainly not the most robust one we've seen, even as far as NES games go. That said, I still think it's pretty fun to play around with, and it's especially useful for getting to levels quickly that otherwise would take a while to get to. Ah yes, my favorite part of Lost Bits. Time again for some unused levels, a whopping 17 of them to be exact. Starting off small, first is an unused fourth two-player stage. This one just has some blocks that aren't seen anywhere else in the game, as well as an arc of coins above. It is believed that this stage would have been used for an also scrapped coin grab minigame in which the player with the most coins at the end of a set timer would win. The other small unused area is a Hammer Bros stage for World 7. Hammer Brothers never appear on the World 7 map, but since this exists, it seems like they might have been planned to at some point. Now moving on to the bigger unused levels, they all appear to be either test levels or early and unfinished versions of levels that are seen in the final game. First up is what appears to be an early version of level 5-3. In this version, you start out on the left side of the stage, while in the final version of 5-3, you start out on the right. This early version also has most of the pipes functioning, which allows you to switch between the top and lower section at will, whereas in the final version, only one of them works. The next unused stage has a similar two-level concept, but here the lower level is underwater. Based on this, it's believed that this might have been an early version of Stage 9 in World 3. It also has a strange ending section. After clearing the first area and going through the pipe that you think would progress the stage, instead of coming out of another pipe, Mario appears out of nowhere in a coin heaven segment, which all leads up to getting a Lakitu's cloud. Now the actual way to beat this unused stage is to have to fly over this wall. So you better have the ability to fly in the stage, otherwise you won't find the actual exit. Next up, we have an unused grassland stage that's thought to be an early version of World 7-3. Some interesting notes about this stage are A, there are absolutely zero ground enemies present here, and B, this stage actually contains the Karibo or Goomba shoe. Now in the final release, for whatever reason, there's one, only one stage that contains the shoe, 5-3. So based on it appearing here, I guess it's nice to know that the item was at least once planned to appear in more than one stage. Moving on, we have this stage, which is very similar to World 1-5. Nothing too crazy here, only this stage has piranhas at the base of each slope, I guess to prevent players from sliding down too much. Next is an interesting stage that includes several what appears to be secret bonus rooms. Even when loading in, they can't all be accessed normally, as entering any of the pipes will just end the level, so a walkthrough walls cheat is necessary to fully explore here. For whatever reason, this also causes the background music to break down into some pretty funky beats. As a bonus, as you can see, all of these rooms also contains a Tanuki suit. It's believed these rooms were just used by the developers to test bonus room layouts before implementing them in the game. Either way, I think these are really cool. Next, we got this here level, which, based on the awful backdrop, appears to have been meant for World 6. It's basically just an unused ice-themed stage, nothing too exciting. The next unused stage also appears to have been meant for World 6, and this auto-scrolling stage bears some resemblance to World 7-4, like this flock of Jelectros. Based on this, some speculate that this stage was once meant for World 6, but it was scrapped and altered to what became the stage in World 7. What I think is super interesting here though is that there's a chance that a gold variant of the Cheep Cheeps can appear. These fellas never appear anywhere else in the entire game, and as such are considered unused. Moving on, we have this vertical level in which Mario would have had to swim up waterfalls to reach the end. It's a pretty short segment, so perhaps either the developers were just testing the idea, or maybe this was just planned to be a sub-area of a larger stage. Either way, a pretty cool concept. Next is a really basic cloud stage with just a few blocks and Koopas. Nothing super crazy, but this stage also contains Parabeetles, which, just like the Karibo Shoe, are only otherwise seen in one stage in the entire game. And just like the Golden Cheep Cheeps, here we can also see an otherwise completely unused green variant of the Parabeetles, which for whatever reason were scrapped. As you've been seeing, the stage also isn't something I'd consider complete, as the vertically moving background causes some graphics to break. Then similarly, there's another cloud level. This one's really small though. Again, the moving background makes the graphics look pretty scuffed sometimes. Then next we got three unused stages, which all appear to be early versions of 1-6 in the game. One is much bigger, with an actual ending. Well, the floor at the end doesn't exist and I wasn't ready for that, so that's nice. Whereas the other two are much smaller and almost identical, minus one of them having removed the entire first row of tiles. Alright, two more unused stages to go. Next is this cloud level with no enemies in sight, just some blocks, coins, and more clouds. What is interesting though is that this stage contains remnants of what appears to be a starry background at the top above the cloud line, an idea that never got used in the game. And lastly is, surprise surprise, yet another cloud level, only this one appears much more basic. It contains several of those stacked unused clouds which I mentioned earlier, which again aren't used anywhere else, and yeah, it just appears to be a test level of sorts. Not the craziest one we've seen in this series, but all unused test rooms are welcome here. Lastly, although it's not an unused level itself, there's actually a secret, normally unused area found in World 4-5. It's normally inaccessible, but with the use of a walkthrough walls cheat, just past this wall is a completely unused exit to the stage. It's unclear why exactly this is here, but who knows, perhaps the developers were toying around with the idea of having secret exits to certain stages, as seen in future Mario games. And speaking of normally unseen stuff, I mentioned the unseen graphics beyond the walls of the throne room earlier, but what's even more interesting is that just above the throne room is actually the graphic that's used for the letters from Princess Toadstool. I guess this is where the graphic is stored. Either that or a giant 30-foot letters floating above castles is just the norm in the Mushroom Kingdom. And that about wraps up Super Mario Bros. 3. If you enjoyed this video, check out some of my other lost bits by clicking or tapping on the card right here. And as always, guys, thank you all so much for tuning in, and I will see you in a bit.